We'd like you to join us this morning on our first sing-along song by Mr. Daniel Namott. It's called More Than Enough. Yes, we are More Than Enough.
More than enough when humanity came to know. Good morning and welcome to the center. It is my joy to welcome you here this morning, and we start with prayer. So please join me. In this holy moment of right now, I know that the truth is the infinite love of God made each one of us, made me in its image and likeness. And so what I know is that each one is fully equipped to live a happy, healthy, prosperous life, just the way they are. Everyone is equipped. What I declare for this morning's service is that there is a perfect communication between listener and speaker, singer, song, presentation, that the whole thing is provided for our up-leveling and deepening our consciousness. So what I know is it's good and very good and only good. I know that the right people are watching and sharing and transmitting this message all around the world. I'm so very grateful for this skill and for this ability. With my heart filled with gratitude, I say thank you, God, and so it is. Today's affirmation is, God is my source. I see this truth through the abundant gifts of life that already surround me. When I see rightly, I am prosperous. And now we'll read our Declaration of Principles. I believe in God, the one creative intelligence operating through the universe and operating throughout my entire being, now and always. I believe this perfect spirit operates upon a law of mind and creates my experience exactly according to my belief. I believe this perfect creative intelligence can be used by me and by every other person to produce health, abundance, and love in mind, body, and total life experience. I use it now, and I rejoice in it, and so it is. We're now going to light the flames of faith. We do this ceremony because we are within the universal consciousness of life. So it acknowledges that all peoples, all faiths, all sentient beings come from the one great universal presence, which we call spirit. Fundamental to this truth is the unifying nature of the all religious thought and experience which we honor here today. We light the candle for the Tao, honoring the universal path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way. We light the candle for the Shamanic traditions, honoring the beliefs and practices of all indigenous people, the way of primal spirituality. We light the candle for Hinduism, honoring the path of knowledge, action, and devotion. We light the candle for Judaism, honoring the ethical path of living by sacred law. We light the candle for all forms of Buddhism, honoring the Four Noble Truths and the path of compassion. We light the candle for all forms of Christianity, honoring the Christ consciousness as the path of love. We light the candle for all forms of Islam, honoring the path of compliance with the will of God as the highest calling. We light the candle for the universalistic religion of Baha'i, honoring the path of unity and peace. We light the candle for all forms of new thought, honoring the metaphysical path of mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. And as practitioner, song leader, singing sensation, etc., Rick Dale lights the last candle, let it represent the path that brought you here this morning. And now we're going to have our meditation song, which will be followed by the meditation presented by Reverend Karen Allen. We will focus our attention on mental recitations of words that have a direct effect on our whole being. And so I'm going to guide you in a couple of mantras. We can say them out loud wherever we are, and then go into them mentally. And then after 2 minutes, we'll have a moment to rest our minds and then move into the next mantra. So I invite you to get comfortable wherever you are and take in a deep breath and feel that breath move through your nose and into your lungs, and gently exhale slowly and deliberately. Allow your eyes to soften and close if they're not already. And we're simply going to start with a statement. I surrender to the power and presence of God within me. I surrender to the power and presence of God within me. I surrender to the power and presence of God within me. I surrender to the power and presence of God within me. I surrender to the power and presence of God within me. And we'll keep that going mentally. Now just take a moment to rest your mind. Say with me, I dwell in unlimited possibility. 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 Now allow your mind to rest for a moment. Say with me now, I am love and compassion. 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 Now, allow your mind to rest for a moment again. I invite you to come back into the room, wiggle your toes and your fingers. And become fully present of this moment right here and right now. And let's welcome up Chelsea Bann.
You know it might not ever come your way. sing it anyway.
Welcome to week three of our series on prosperity, where you get to experience the ideas of prosperity from different points of view from your different ministers. So I'm going to start with just a brief overview of what Dr. Heather and Reverend Judy spoke about the first 2 weeks. So in week one, Dr. Heather reminded us that prosperity is not just our money substance. It is also our relationships, our friendships, our family. It is also tithing 10% of our income to the source of our inspiration. And she told the stories about Mary Morrissey and how she turned her last $3 into 80 through tithing, and Edwin Gaines, who shifted her whole consciousness through tithing to a really a place of faith beyond what she ever knew. And then Dr. Heather reminded us to be clear on what we do want in terms of time, money, freedom, and to use our imaginations to outpicture what it is that we'd like to see in our lives. And then last week, Reverend Judy reminded us of the power of affirmations and the power of our word. She also spoke about tithing and gratitude, which is the great multiplier. And then she gave us this gift of how we can let go of our lack and limitation through our full body experience of the releasing prayer. I release my belief in lack. I release all my needs. I am grateful God is the wealth that I am. Today, my message is, you got this. Because you do got this, and I got this. I am going to present today ideas about prosperity, and I feel actually very confident in giving this talk because I feel prosperous. I am prosperous, and I'm not living in a multi-million dollar mansion and earning a seven-figure income, nor am I flying off to exotic places around the world on a whim. Yet I am prosperous. When I say I'm prosperous, I'm not bragging. I'm simply acknowledging the fact that I am surrounded by amazing friends and family who support me through everything in life. When I say I am prosperous, I say that I have avenues by which I may express God's creativity through me. Could be music, could be dance, could be speaking. When I say I am prosperous, I am thankful that my eyes can see, my ears can hear, my feet can dance, my arms can hug, my lungs can breathe, that I am whole. When I say I am prosperous, I know that I have established my unwavering faith of God by means of tithing. When I say I am prosperous, I realize my clarity of thought by using the science of mind principles in my life. And when I say I am prosperous, I am acknowledging that I am blessed, that I am happy, that I am healthy, and that I'm grateful. And I've not always been prosperous. In fact, before taking prosperity classes,
I was anything but prosperous. There was a time in my life when I was a single mom of three children on a very limited budget, and anytime someone would ask me to do something or go somewhere, oh, no, I can't do that. I can't afford it. I gotta pay my bills. I gotta feed my children. Well, through the years, I have taken many, many prosperity classes. Financial Freedom, Four T's of Prosperity, Prosperity Plus, Five Gifts, many of them. And through those classes, my consciousness has shifted. My life has been transformed. And through those tools and those ideas, those concepts that Dr. Heather and Reverend Judy spoke about, I just had amazing shifts in my life in that prosperity consciousness. Yet, I didn't always see it. So today I'm going to present you with some ideas that are going to help you rightly see your prosperity, because it is there, and I trust that you will be able to recognize it. So what does seeing rightly look like? First and foremost, learning to appreciate what you already have is seeing rightly, and it's also the first step in achieving prosperity. So I invite you to take a moment and just think about the surroundings, your surroundings, the people that love you, the people in your life, the bed you woke up in, the roof over your head, the food you ate for breakfast, the air that you can breathe. And it sounds like a gratitude list, because it is. And over the years, keeping gratitude lists has really shifted my own perspective about appreciating all the things in life, the little, the big, when we actually know that there's no big or small to the mind that knoweth all, right? It's all something to be appreciated. In one of our prosperity classes, Dr. Heather introduced us to the idea of keeping a book of evidentials. And this is my notebook where I get to write down all the good that comes into my life. I got a raise, log it. Someone gave me a new car, I log it. Someone opened the door for me, I log it. And this is not only serving me when I'm writing it as the great multiplier, it especially serves me when I'm not feeling so prosperous. When I'm feeling down, which we all go through that, I can open my book of evidentials and see evidence of my good and remind myself that I am prosperous. So learning to appreciate what we already have is seeing rightly. Seeing rightly also means acknowledging God's beauty everywhere. Of course, we live in this beautiful area of San Clemente that we get to see, and it's easy when you're seeing the beautiful colors, the trees, the waterfalls out in nature. Ah, it's easy to see God's beauty. But when I mean everywhere, that means everywhere. That means even in the creepy crawly bugs and the rotting compost garbage. I can do that. But what about those horrific events or those most challenging people in our lives? You know, as we see in media, it's very apparent that we are going through some rather polarizing times in our country. There are people who just are not agreeing with each other over everything. And it's become political, and it's become ugly, and it's just, people are so angry. If we're so able to see that beauty in nature, the diversity of nature, and acknowledge that as beautiful, the compost and the creepy crawly bugs, why are we not able to see it in our fellow brothers and sisters, our human fellow brothers and sisters who think differently, who look differently? I want to invite you to think about your favorite color for a moment. We've got purple over here and teal over here, I know it. And imagine you're at this large buffet and everything is your favorite color. Everything looks the same. Everything smells the same. Everything tastes the same. How boring would that be? Even if all of it were creme brulee. Now, erase that visual for a moment. Now imagine a huge smorgasbord of delectable delights, all different colors, different smells, different textures, tastes. Ah, great variety. Of course, I'm not going to like everything on that table, but somebody else will. And we're not going to hold that against them, are we? If they choose the chicken fried steak over the vegetable lasagna, we're not going to hold that against them. If we consider the people in our lives as the beautiful buffet of life in all of its variety, the different ways we dress, the different things we eat, our different political views, then we'd be able to see, maybe we could see the differences as something beautiful rather than something by which we choose to judge another. I love that we light the flames of faith every Sunday because it is a reminder of our oneness with each other, our oneness with everybody, no matter what your belief is. But can you imagine? We light the candle for the Tao, honoring the universal path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way, unless you're a Republican or unless you're a Democrat. That goes against everything that we teach, everything that we believe. And as we are able to rightly see the beauty of God expressed as all sentient beings, especially those who challenge us, only then can we experience true prosperity. Another way to see rightly is to notice the energy of life that is everywhere. In the Celestine Prophecy, James Redfield talks about this energy that sustains us, that responds to us as we draw from this infinite source. Of course, he's talking about God in more esoteric terms. Tapping into the infinite source of this infinite energy allows us to live big and full out. Henry David Thoreau said, "Wealth, which is a synonym for prosperity, is the ability to fully experience life." So when we pray and align ourselves with that one, there is a spiritual realization of our oneness with it, with that energy. Our energy and that energy are one. And as we utilize this energy in our lives in a positive way, in all of our affairs, while remembering that it is endless, it is infinite, never to expire, we can say within ourselves, I am whole. I am prosperous. We are like those electric vehicles that never run out of gas. All we need to do is plug into source. This next one may sound like a song by Jason Mraz, because it is. Look for the good in everything. Looking for the good in everything is seeing rightly. You know, for many years, one of our center's recitations was, God is good all the time, 24/7, 365. I love that. And it's so easy. It's so easy to do when everything's going your way. Oh, gosh, I got a raise. God is good. Oh, gosh, I was given this amazing gift. God is good. But when we are going through a difficult time again, when things are not so wonderful, looking for the good actually prompts us to do some deep inner contemplation. It causes us to redirect our focus. Deep down, we all recognize the power of God, otherwise we wouldn't be here listening or seeing. But when we're experiencing difficult times, maybe financial, spiritual, or physical, we fall prey to our human victim mode mentality, and we forget who and whose we are. And we forget that God, which is a synonym for good, is everywhere present. When I was a newbie at this center, I'd been here for about 6 months. This was back in 1998. I took a class, I believe it was Financial Freedom, and Reverend Virginia Barnes was teaching it. And they were talking about good, and this was about the time when the Columbine shootings happened. And I just had to ask her, I had to inquire, how is there good in that situation? My heart was hurting, and I said, how can you see good in this? And she prefaced it by saying that this is not an easy concept to grasp. But she said that there is good being revealed. She said, we may not be able to see it or even fathom it, but beyond our own human understanding, there is some good going on, because the omniscient God is present. And part of our good is having the faith, is actually having the faith that good is coming out of it. So if there can be good in the Columbine shootings or any other horrific event, there has to be good in the elections, no matter what the outcome. Just because we can't not see it, we cannot see it, doesn't mean it's not there. Seeking wisdom is also seeing rightly. So Socrates said, an unexamined life is not worth living. For only in striving to come to know ourselves and understand ourselves better does our life have any meaning or value. So we are to seek lessons simply by observing ourselves, particularly as we are observing others. In seeking wisdom, judgment is not a necessity, but discernment is. So what is the difference? The dictionary definition of judgment is an opinion or estimate, criticism or censure, power of comparing or deciding. So judgment assumes that there is a person who is judging as though they are better than another. They're also judging as though what they say, they know what good is for everybody. It's not just their point of view. Judgment also has a sense of finality, like passing a sentence. We've all been judged before, and it tends to stick to us, kind of like duct tape, right? And it comes up days or even years later. Discernment, however, is a more personal and conscious approach. So Webster's Dictionary says it is to discern is to separate mentally from another or others, to recognize as separate or different, and to perceive or recognize to make out clearly. With discernment, we make good choices for both ourselves and for others. And in Sanskrit, there is a word, viveka, which means discernment, but is implied that we are seeing things as they are from our inner selves rather than from the outer. Seeing from something much deeper than our egos. So when we use viveka, we are seeking wisdom and we are seeing rightly. Forgiving is seeing rightly. So how many of us hold on to resentments from the past? And how is that working for you? And how long are you going to hold on to that? Materially, there is nothing we can do to change what has happened in the past, but what we can change is how and if we allow it to affect us. That's when our choice of forgiving comes into play. Forgiveness is not about accepting poor or dangerous behavior. It's about letting go of the thoughts, letting go of the emotions and the feelings that plague us and no longer serve us. Forgiveness is about opening our hearts to the idea that everyone is human, that everyone is fallible, and that everyone possesses an ego. As human beings, we all make mistakes. We all make poor choices. And if we held on to every one of those, we would be a mess. And as we hold on to that of others around us, we are just imprisoned in this circle of ick. The act of forgiveness is one of the most freeing gifts you can give yourself. And it also provides you with a peace that is beyond priceless. And when we forgive ourselves and forgive others, we are freed and we are seeing rightly. And lastly, acknowledging sufficiency is seeing rightly. And I'd like to share with you a quote from romance and women's fiction writer, Faith Baldwin. She said this, "Praying, we usually ask too much. I know I do. Sometimes we even demand. I think I'm learning to ask enough for the moment, not for the whole year, utterly veiled in mystery, not even for the week, the month ahead, but just for today." Jesus said it all when he told us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread." That bread is not only material, it is spiritual. In asking for it, we ask for a sufficiency of strength, courage, hope, and light. Enough courage for the step ahead, not for the further miles. Enough strength for the immediate task or ordeal. Enough material gain to enable us to meet our daily obligations. Enough light to see the path right before our feet. And I love this quote because it is a reminder to be in the now, to be in the present moment, because right now, everything is sufficient. And if we focus on the now, we don't have to worry about what may happen in the future. Our sufficiency, our recognition of our sufficiency right now is seen rightly, and it is your prosperity. You got this. Everything that you need to experience prosperity is already within you. By seeing rightly with your mind, with your heart, with your soul, the infinite source of light and love just outshines any obstacle to truth. And your real prosperity is being revealed. Yes, prosperity does mean financial freedom and money substance, but it also means recognizing what you already have, seeing the beauty, the goodness, the sufficiency, the wisdom, the peace, and the wholeness that you already are. Live in these principles, and you'll watch prosperity flow into your life. In 3 John chapter 2, it says, "Beloved, I pray you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers." And my beloved ones, I pray the same for you. And so it is. Now let's pray. Knowing that infinite source is right here, right now, and I am plugged into it. Its energy is my energy. Its love is my love. Its peace is my peace. I acknowledge that. I live it. I move it. I breathe it right here and right now. For I am one with it. For all are one with it. We are one with each other. We are one with life. We are God in expression in our very, very unique and beautiful ways. So as we go forth, each one of us goes forth in our week. I know that each one recognizes those gifts of prosperity that are already within them. I know that it is seen, it is felt, it is heard, it is smelled, it is known that this infinite life is each one's life. And that as each one remembers the truth of their being, that all is well. And each one can say, I am prosperous. I am prosperous. I am prosperous. This is truth. Truth in action. Truth in expression. Truth as each one. And so I simply give thanks. I give thanks for knowing this truth. I give thanks for expressing this truth. And I give thanks for all the blessings that surround me and fold me, that are within me. And so I simply let go and allow that law, which does its work, to do it. And so it is. And now it's my pleasure to invite back to the platform Chelsea Van.
Thank you, Chelsea. That was wonderful. And thank you, Reverend Karen, Wonderful meditation, fantastic message. I know all of you at home are also acknowledging her like crazy. So it's now time for us to share our financial substance. And so it's time for practicing that law of circulation. If you want to text to give, the number is 844-948-3044. Of course, you can write a check. You can drop it by the center or put it in the mail, and or you could go to our Facebook page and our website, I should say, and our PayPal account. There are all sorts of ways for you to give, and we're grateful for them all. I'd like to acknowledge a couple of things. First of all, these beautiful flowers, the ones on my to my right, are from Dan Martin this morning, and the ones over on the side and the ones behind us are from the memorial service for Sheila Prevost-Maltinsky. Her family left them for us, and they smell wonderful, and we've been enjoying them. I also have something really great to remind you of. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, is, well, the whole day, is International Peace Day. And at 7 o'clock, we will be celebrating through a concert. So tune in to Facebook Live tomorrow at 7. You'll be so happy you did spend an hour of celebrating the peace within you and around the world, and join some of our wonderful musicians for a live concert. Now, taking that check that you have written in your hand, this is a great time to acknowledge. My offering is my acceptance of God as the source of my supply and symbolizes my faith in the abundant flow of this supply. And so it is. So that brings us to the end of our service up until the peace song, which will begin momentarily. Reminder that right after service, we have coffee and conversations, we have prayer rooms, and then at 12 o'clock we have conscious connecting. So, let there be peace on earth. With you, we are prosperous, and so it is.